Very good evening, happy Valentine Day and very warm welcome to one and all on behalf of Dental Council of India in this series of virtual webinar. At the outset, I would like to congratulate Dental Council of India for taking the initiative to start virtual webinars during lockdown period and more importantly, continuing consistently since June 20th. Covering various topics of almost all the specialties. It is a matter of pride that the participants in these webinars are not only from India, but this has been gained recognition and appreciation globally. I hope for the same enthusiasm will continue in the coming webinars. So before we start with the webinar, I will like to give some announcements so that you can take your e-certificates easily. So starting with the announcements. At the time of registration, complete and proper details must be furnished since the same will be captured for generating certificates, CDE points. No request for any change or modification in their details shall be considered. An e-certificate of attendees will be emailed to all the attendees on their registered email. CD points will be awarded to the dentist registered with state dental councils or tribunals of India. Certificates will be sent to the attendees by email within 3 days of conclusion of each webinar who have attended the entire session of webinar uninterrupted. Please check your junk email folder just in case the certificate email got delivered there instead of your inbox. In case of any query or issue, please drop email at webinardci@gmail.com. In case you missed the previous webinar, please feel free to visit our site at dciindia.gov.in and go to webinar session. Please do spare some time to give your feedback. Fill the feedback form that you will receive at email along with your email certificate. So this is the only way by which we can make the improvements. I feel proud and honored to announce the names of 5 topmost dental colleges who have the highest attendance in their last. Savitha Dental College and Hospital, Chennai, St. Joseph Mahavidyalaya Institute of Dental Sciences and Research Center, Hyderabad, Nubhagambi Dental College and Hospital, Chennai, Guru Nanak Dev Institute of Dental Sciences and Research, Kolkata. Congratulations to all these 5 dental colleges. The topic of today's webinar is technique of minor dento-alveolar surgeries and management of impacted mandibular third molars. And the speaker is none other than Dr. Subhash Bhoyer, who doesn't need introduction. But considering my responsibility to introduce him briefly, he is professor and director, CSMSS Dental College and Hospital, Aurangabad, member Dental Council of India, ex-president MSDC Mumbai, member of Academic Council and Faculty of Dentistry, MUHS Nasik, chairman BOS MUHS Nasik, ex-president of AOMSI Maharashtra chapter, teacher of teachers with more than 38 years of teaching experience. Here we go and humbly invite Dr. Bhoyer to start with this webinar. Dr. Bhoyer, please.
A very good afternoon to all of you. I'm very happy to welcome all the participants for this DCI platform for the digital learning. Thank you, respected Dr. Jeevan Latha Madam, and all the esteemed, respected members of the DCI, the Executive Council members, the webinar committee members, the Honorable President and Honorable Secretary of DCI, all the administrative staff of DCI for giving this opportunity to me to share my knowledge to our professionals. Now it's my duty to introduce our today's esteemed moderator for this webinar, Professor Dr. Jeevan Latha Madam, who is the Dean at Punjab Government Dental College and Hospital, Amritsar. She is a very senior DCI member and also she is the president for the Punjab State Dental Council, Chandigarh. Thank you, madam. It was a long-standing academic requirement of our dental faculty to have the DCI CDI activities, which the DCI is fulfilling by presenting this series of webinars. My topic for today's webinar is the techniques in minor oral and dentoalveolar surgery and the management of impacted tooth, mandibular, third molar. Hopefully, I will do justice with this basic oral surgery topic, which is immensely useful for the private practitioner, UG and PG students. Before I start my webinar topic, may I request all of you to please keep 1 minute silence in the fond memory of a sad demise of our great surgeon, a great teacher, and a great leader in our profession, Professor Dr. Dhanasekara, who was very popularly known as NKD. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. May his soul rest in peace. Now let's begin with our webinar topic. Thank you. Yeah, it's a minor oral surgery, the dentoalveolar surgery. We all know that most of the surgery is performed by the oral and maxillofacial surgeons. They are the minor oral surgeries, mainly the dentoalveolar surgeries, which can be performed very safely and conveniently in majority of the well-set dental clinics and in minor OT with the physiological dental chair under the local anesthesia. Usually they are minor in nature, very safe, less morbid, and can be completed in less than 1 hour with good prognosis. The various minor oral surgeries performed very routinely, they are under the dentoalveolar surgeries, its exodontia, impaction, dental implants, epsectomy, reimplantation and transplantation of the tooth, pre-prosthetic surgeries like alveoloplasty, elimination of the smaller benign lesion, management, etc. Under the minor oral soft tissue surgeries, very routinely we do incision and drainage of the abscess, biopsies, pre-prosthetic surgeries like sulcoplasty, prenectomy, removal of the small benign growth like cyst and tumor, like mucosal and all, epilis, closure of the oroenteral communications, sialolithotomy, removal of the pericoronal flap. They are very simple and less morbid in nature, and they can be done very safely, not only by oral and maxillofacial surgeon, but any competent dental clinic, if they follow all the principle of surgery, especially the asepsis and all, they can do it in their own clinics under the local anesthesia without the help of anesthetist. Under the dentoalveolar surgery, it comprises mainly the exodontia. It's a branch of the oral surgery and it deals mainly with the extraction of the teeth, including the impacted teeth. How to define the tooth extraction? It's a skillful, painless, atraumatic removal of the indicated tooth under the suitable anesthesia with the minimum trauma to the investing tissue so that the wound heals uneventfully and no prosthetic complications created in future, like for placing the implants and all. The principal steps what we follow during the tooth extraction. Initially, we give the apical pressures by the insertion of the wedge, that is the bix of the forceps or the blade of the elevator between the tooth root and the bony socket for the socket expansion and for elevation of the tooth into the socket. Following it, we use the liver and fulcrum principle for elevating the tooth with the help of dental elevator. Thereafter, we do the further expansion of the bony socket with the help of dental forceps with buccal and lingual pressure movement. And then it is followed by half rotation or figure-eight movement. And finally, with the final traction movement, we remove the tooth in a buccal or labial directions. The figures are showing the different movements when we give the apical pressure, buccal lingual pressure, rotations, and final traction movement, it is shown there. The various indications for the tooth extractions, we know that even though it is simple, it is basic, but all must know it when to remove the tooth to prevent any medical legal problems. The grossly carious tooth or root with pulpal and periapical pathology, which is beyond saving with the conservative treatment, the advanced periodontitis with gradatory mobility of the tooth, the over-retained deciduous tooth, the malposed tooth, the impacted tooth, the supernumerary tooth, the extraction for the orthodontic purpose, the extraction for the prosthetic purpose, teeth in the line of fracture line, the traumatically severely luxated and fractured tooth, the tooth involved with the soft tissue or the bony pathology like cyst and tumor, the prior to the radiation therapy in oral malignancy to prevent the osteoradionecrosis, and teeth which are responsible for focal infection in medical compromised patients, we try to remove that tooth. For every indication, there can be relative contraindications as well, which could be local or they can be systemic as well. Under the local, any tooth, even though it is indicated, if it is involved with the acute infection like pericoronitis, acute periapical infections, acute periodontitis, acute sinusitis, acute osteomyelitis, we must take the due care, we must delay the infections, we must control those infections, then only the tooth can be removed. Then the tooth involved in the malignant growth or which has been associated with the vascular tumor or anomaly like cavernous hemangioma or arteriovenous shunt, we should take all due cares before we attempt to remove that tooth to prevent the fatal bleeding or the spread of the malignant growth. Then the tooth it's a relative contraindication to remove the tooth from the irradiated jaws to prevent the osteoradionecrosis. As far as possible, it should be done very atraumatically under the antibiotic cover. So also we have got the systemic contraindications like severely medically compromised patients, like with cardiac problems on anticoagulant therapy, the patient with the uncontrolled diabetic, severely hypertensive patients with renal problems, with endocrinal problems like hypothyroidism on steroids, with contagious active diseases like HIV, viral hepatitis, COVID-19 infections. They are all the relative contraindications. Now, given a choice, when the patients go for the multiple teeth extractions, like for the oral complete mouth rehabilitations, we have to follow certain sequence. Normally, the loose and the painful teeth are removed first. Then the roots are extracted before the whole tooth. Upper teeth are removed before the lower teeth. The posterior teeth are removed before the anterior teeth so that not to obstruct the vision. The first molar is removed after the second molar or the second premolar to induce the cortical expansion to make the removal of the first molar easier without any fracturing. And so also when we attempt the removal of the canine and if there is a choice for multiple extraction, then the first premolar and lateral incisor should be removed first, followed by the canine extractions. Now the techniques, methods, types of teeth extraction. First is the intraoral extraction, intraalveolar extraction. It is also known as the forceps or the elevator technique. It's a closed and simple technique of extraction. And in this technique, a direct access is gained on a tooth to be extracted. It consists of removing the indicated tooth or root by the use of suitable forceps and elevator. Before placing the forceps or elevator, the soft tissue, that is the marginal gingiva around the neck of the tooth should be separated by the point. Pricks of the forceps should be held on the tooth parallel to its long axis below the cemento enamel junctions of the tooth, that is on the root surface. And then by slow and steady laxative movement, the movement should be given initially 1 mm, that is grade 1 mobility, further movement grade 2 mobility, and then finally the tooth should be removed in a buccal or labial direction with the final tractions. Following the removal of the tooth, the socket should be compressed with gentle compression. Over compression should be avoided because it will induce the future prosthetic problems, like width in that area of the alveolar ridge will be reduced and it will create the problems in placement of the implant. It is followed by placing the sterile gauze over. The figures are showing the different movements when we give while doing the intraalveolar extractions. The advantages of the intraalveolar extractions are, it's a very simple technique. It is an atraumatic conservative technique. There is a rapid healing of the wound with good retention of the blood clot. The second type of technique for doing the extraction is a transalveolar technique. It is also known as surgical extraction or the open or the complicated technique of tooth extraction. Here the access on a tooth or root is gained by raising the mucoperiosteal flap. It's a method of recovering the fractured tooth or root which occurs during the intraalveolar extractions. Following the clinical and radiological assessment with proper diagnosis, the flap is reflected for removal of the bone and the tooth in this technique by transalveolar dissection, by removing the covering alveolar bone, and then by sectioning the tooth or root, we remove them out. After removal of the tooth, the socket and the tooth should be inspected properly, followed by control of the bleeding, debridement of the socket, finishing and cleaning of the socket with the normal saline or betadine solution, followed by closure of the wound with the suture. Normally, the interrupted suture we give with pressure gauze pack and then post-operative medications and the instructions. This is the figure showing the transalveolar type of extraction, the surgical extraction. The tooth has been shown with the unfavorable root pattern and it is one of the indications for the transalveolar extraction. The other indications for the transalveolar extractions are, number one, any tooth which offers a lot of resistance by forceps and elevator or luxation during the intraalveolar technique or get fractured during the intraalveolar technique should go for the transalveolar extraction, that is surgical extraction. Then if there is a previous history of attempted or failed extractions given by the patient, then we should plan it for the surgical extraction after assessing clinically and radiologically. Then the retained inaccessible roots embedded into the soft tissue, or if the tooth is brittle, especially the root canal treated teeth, we should plan for the transalveolar extraction. Then the tooth having the hypersymmetrosis or ankylosed tooth or dilacerated tooth, we should plan for the transalveolar extraction. Then the tooth with the unfavorable root pattern, then the tooth associated with the pathology like cyst and tumor or lying in a fracture line, it has to go for the transalveolar extractions. Then of course, the impacted and embedded teeth has to be removed by surgical technique of transalveolar extractions. Now we are going for the impacted mandibular third molar, that is the wisdom tooth. We'll be covering this topic under the introduction, definition, frequency of impaction of different teeth, etiology and causes of impaction, local systemic theories of impaction, indication and contraindication for its removal, classification of the impacted third molar, especially by the George Winter, Pale and Gregory, and then based on the nature of the overlying soft tissues. Then the preoperative assessment of the patients by taking the detailed history, clinical and radiological examination. Then the surgical extraction difficulty indices, which include the war lines, Pedersen scales and Warpage index scales. Then we'll cover the surgical technique of removal of the impacted mandibular third molar, followed by the postoperative instruction and medications. Now this impacted mandibular third molar. The word impaction is from the Latin origin, impactus, that is the obstructions. The age of eruption of the mandibular third molar is from 17 to 21 years of age, and that is the its root completion occurs in between 18 to 25 years of age. The third molar are the last to erupt into the oral cavity and hence they are very prone for getting impacted. Mandibular third molar is the most commonly impacted tooth, and surgical removal of the impacted teeth is one of the most commonly performed surgical procedure, not only by oral and maxillofacial surgeon, but all the practicing dental surgeons. How do we define the impaction? The tooth which has been completely or partially unerupted and it is positioned against the another tooth, bone or the soft tissue so that its further eruption is unlikely, we call it as an impaction. The order of frequency of the impaction, that is incidence in descending order, it's a mandibular third molar, it is most commonly impacted tooth, followed by the maxillary third molar, then the maxillary canine, then the mandibular premolar, then the mandibular canine, then the maxillary bicuspid, maxillary lateral incisor and maxillary central incisor. This is the descending order of frequency for their impactions. Then the etiology and causes of impaction, according to Berger and Archer, they could be local etiology, it could be systemic etiology. Under the local etiology, Number one, it is the irregularity in the position and pressure from the neighboring tooth. There could be increased density of the overlying and the surrounding bone. It could be due to increased density of the overlying soft tissue. There may be inadequate space in the dental arch due to underdeveloped or small size of the jaw, and this tooth being a last tooth to erupt to get impacted. There could be over-retention and premature loss of deciduous tooth. It is true in case of canine impactions. Then there could be dilaceration of the roots of the tooth, which could be traumatic. There may be involvement with the associated pathology like cyst and tumor, like dentigerous cyst or the ameloblastoma, they get impacted, and there could be ectopic position of the tooth bud. Under the systemic causes, it could be prenatal cause. It is in the form of hereditary in nature, or it could be postnatal causes and various systemic conditions. It could be rickets, anemia, malnutrition, congenital syphilis, TB, hypothyroidism, etc. And the rare causes which causes a multiple impaction, it could be cleidocranial dysostosis, it could be osteopetrosis, and also the different teeth are found impacted and multiple teeth in a cleft palate patients. Now the theories of impactions. Most of these theories, they stresses on the discrepancy of the jaw size with that of the tooth size. And the prominent main theories they are, number one is the phylogenetic theory. Due to the evolution and civilization, there is a change in chewing habit of a person's chewing of the soft food. The human jaw is becoming smaller in size, causing the impaction of the teeth, especially the third molar being the last tooth to erupt, get frequently impacted. Then the Mendelian theory, it's due to the genetic variations, hereditary transmission of the small jaw and the large teeth from different parents, that is the mother and father. It can be the etiological factor for the impaction because of the lack of space in a dental arch. The other theories, they are the orthodontic theory. As per this theory, the jaws and teeth normally move in an anterior direction during the growth, and any restriction in a forward movement due to the increased bone density, due to the chronic inflammation or trauma, can result into the impaction of the teeth. It has been found that in mouth breather, due to the contracted jaw, there is a frequent impaction. Due to the early loss of deciduous teeth also, it can lead to the impaction. Then the pathologic theory, due to the chronic infection, there may be condensation of the overlying soft tissue and the hard tissue, causing the impaction of the teeth. It could be due to the endocrinal theory hypothesis, the increase or the decrease in growth hormone can lead to the impaction of the teeth. Now, what is to be done of the impacted tooth? The indication for its removal. Now, it is our experience that unless contraindicated, all the symptomatic impacted teeth should be removed. And it is estimated that about 85% of the third molars undergo removal. Impacted teeth being a potential source and cause for the further complications and problems. Hence, even the asymptomatic impacted teeth are advisable for prophylactic removal at an early age after their diagnosis. Why? Because in younger age group, its removal is comparatively easier and there is less complications and healing is faster. So whether they are symptomatic, definitely they should be removed. But also if they are asymptomatic and if they are diagnosed, they should be removed at the earliest to prevent the future problems. The various conditions for which the impacted tooth should be removed, because they can create the different signs and symptoms and complaints in a patient, they can be summarized as under. Number one, for the prevention of the food lodgement distal to the second molar, or for the prevention of the formation of the periodontal pocket distal to 7, the tooth is advised to be removed. Then for prevention of the dental caries in the distal aspect of the second molar or on mesial aspect of the third molar, and they are inaccessible in that area because impacted tooth, when it is partly erupted, the caries, they are not detectable, neither it can be restored, and therefore the impacted tooth should be removed before it causes the dental caries on a distal aspect of the second molar. Then for prevention of the infection like pericoronitis, percuvent pericoronitis, cellulitis, abscess, the impacted tooth should go for the removal. For prevention of the root resorption of the neighboring tooth, that is second molar, to prevent that, the impacted tooth should be removed. For prevention of the development of the pathology like odontogenic cyst and tumor, like dentigerous cyst or the ameloblastoma, they arises in the follicle of the impacted tooth. And for prevention of this future development of this pathological lesion, the impacted tooth should be removed. For prevention of the ulceration and pain underneath the prosthesis, if the prosthesis is given without removal of the impacted tooth, definitely due to the impingement of the prosthesis from the oral mucosa, it induces ulceration and pain, and that is why it should be removed. For treating the it is advisable to remove the impacted tooth. For facilitating the orthodontic treatment like for retraction of the lower anteriors, prior to the orthognathic surgery like sagittal split osteotomy, the impacted teeth should be removed. And then the patient who are undergoing the radiotherapy for oral malignancy, for oral transplant, that is for transplanting the developing third molar from the socket of third molar to the missing first molar. Then the patient having the ENT and ophthalmic some kind of operations. Then it is advisable to remove the third molar for the prophylactic purpose. Then the contraindication, when the impacted tooth should not be removed, even though it is symptomatic or on a prophylactic basis, normally we advise the removal, but in certain conditions, we don't advise the removal of the impacted tooth, and they are the contraindications. The policy is that if the benefit of surgical removal are less than the complication it creates, then the removal of the impacted tooth is contraindicated, whatever is the conditions. But if the benefit are less and complications are more, then either do not remove the third molar or delay it. And the different conditions are this: the patients with advanced age with the brittle bone, and if the impaction is very deep, then there is a possibility of the jaw fracture, the impacted tooth should not be removed. Then the patient who are medically compromised, in them the impaction, the surgical removal of the impacted should be avoided to prevent the risk of developing the surgical complications, systemic complications. If there is a risk of damage to the adjacent structure like the content of the periodontal canal or the fracture of the jawbone, because if it is atrophic mandible and having the deep impaction, then it should not be removed. Then the partly erupted third molar, it can be utilized as abutment tooth for supporting the bridge, and in that case it may be retained, it should not be removed. Then how do we classify the impacted third molar? The impacted third molar, mandibular third molar, they are classified radiographically by their angulation, by their depth, and by its relationship with the anterior border of the vertical ramus. The classification system helps to assess and identify the exact position, angulation, depth of the third molar, and to assess the level of difficulty in surgical removal of the impacted third molar. The most commonly used classification, they are mainly three. Number one, it is the George Winters classification. It is based on the position of the long axis of the third molar in relation with the long axis of the second molar. And it, as per this classification, we have got eight type of impacted teeth. What if
I think Dr. Subhash is out of connection, so he will join very early, very soon he will join.
It is based on the relation of the impacted tooth with the ramus of mandible and with the second molar. It is in a horizontal plane. As per this classification, it could be class 1, class 2, and class 3. Class 1, there is a sufficient space, and in class 3, there is no space in between the ramus and the second molar, and in this type of classification the third molar is found into the vertical ramus. The figures are showing the type of different types of classes of third molar impaction as per the Pale and Gregory. Now, based in the same classification based given by the Pale and Gregory, it is also are classified as position A, B, and C based on the relative depth of the third molar in a bone in a vertical plane. Position A is that impaction where the highest portion of the tooth is at or above the occlusal plane of second molar. Position B, where the highest portion of the tooth is in between the occlusal plane and above the cervical line of second molar. And position C, the highest point of the third molar is below the cervical line of second molar. It's a deep impaction, it's a bony impactions, and it will be difficult impactions. Then the third type of classification, it is based on the nature of the overlying tissue, and it is as per this classification it could be soft tissue impaction. Here the impacted tooth is erupted out of the bone and covered only with the dense fibrous soft tissue. And in hard tissue impaction, that is a bony impaction, it may be partial or it may be complete bony impaction. In partial bony impaction, the tooth is partly covered with the bone and on reflection of the soft tissue it will be visible. In complete bony impaction, the tooth is completely inside the bone and even after reflection of the soft tissue it will not be visible. Then how do we do the preoperative assessment of the impacted tooth in a patient? Initially we take the dental history along with the and we do the clinical and radiological examination of the patient to make the correct diagnosis, and we plan the treatment for the surgical removal of the impacted tooth. The various signs and symptoms, which are the clinical feature which are commonly seen in a patient with impacted tooth. Number one, frequently the patients will have pain and swelling due to the infections in a third molar area, which could be due to the pericoronitis, it could be due to the abscess, or it could be due to the cellulitis. At times, it may remain asymptomatic, painless, and it is discovered accidentally during the routine radiography. Very frequently found symptom, second symptom is the trismus. It is a difficulty in opening the mouth, which is accompanied with the painful chewing, painful swallowing, and difficulty in speaking. Then the patient may have the food lodgment in the periodontal pocket distal to second molar, which may be accompanied with the periodontitis and the foul odor from the mouth. The third molar may be partly erupted or it may be fully embedded in the third molar area and it will be missing from the dental arch. The partly erupted teeth may be cariously involved. There may be chick biting in the third molar area due to the buccally placed third molars, may be upper third molar or lower third molar, or maybe due to the over eruption of the upper third molar. And there the patient may have the submandible lymph nodes tender and palpable due to the infection in the third molar area due to the draining. Then following the clinical examination, normally we go for the radiological assessment to diagnose and to assess the third molar impactions. Usually it is done with the IOPA, and this IOPA may be supplemented with OPG or with CBCT to get the detailed information regarding the type of impactions in regards to its angulations, depth, and class of impactions. In X-ray, we come to know its morphology, shape of the crown, number of the roots, whether they are favorable or unfavorable. Any associated pathology will be detected in X-ray. Condition of second molar will be assessed. Condition of the surrounding bone for denseness as sclerosis will be assessed. Then its relations with the interdental canal will be studied. If there is a narrowing of the root apex and with the bifid root, if there is a radiolucent band running across the root apex, if there is a deflection of the root and the interdental canal, and if there is a narrowing of the canal and the interruption of the superior border of the canal, all these conditions, they suggest the intimate relationship and possibility of the damage to the interdental nerve and vessels during the surgical removal. So after assessing, you have to take the due care, and you have to inform the patients beforehand only, before the operation, so that patient is mentally ready and will cooperate and will give the verbal consent to you along with the written consents. In IOPA, another assessment, radiological assessment, it's about the external oblique ridge. If the inclination of the external oblique ridge, if it is found vertical, the shadow of the external oblique ridge, then the access to the third molar area will be very difficult, and the impaction also will be difficult to remove. But if the shadow casted by the external oblique ridge, if it is horizontal, then the approach will be easier comparatively. The position and the depth and the angulation of impacted third molar can be assessed also by the war lines. The Winters war lines have been shown here, white lines, amber line, and red line. The George Winters line, these are the three imaginary lines drawn on IOPA taken on for the impacted third molar. They are used to detect the position and depth of the impacted third molar. First is the white line. It indicates the inclination and the depth position of the third molar. It is drawn along the cusp of the erupted molars and extended posteriorly. The second line is the amber line. It is drawn along the shadow of the external oblique ridge to the crest of the interdental bone between the molars. It shows the amount of the bone covering the crown of the impacted tooth. The portion of the tooth in front of this amber line, normally it is visible after reflection of the mucoperiosteal flap. The third line is the red line. It is a perpendicular drawn from the amber line to the imaginary point of application of for an elevator on the cemento enamel junction on the medial side. It is usually on medial side for all type of impaction except on the distal side for the distal angular impactions. It measures the depth of the impacted tooth in a bone, and it indicates the amount of the bone that will have to be removed to reach to the point of elevations. The significance is that if its length is less than 5 mm, the impaction is comparatively easier to remove. But with every increase of 1 mm length, the surgical difficulty increases 3 times. And it is said that if it is more than 9 mm, the red line, then it is very difficult impaction and it is advisable to be removed under the GA. Now, the prediction of the surgical difficulty while removing the third molar. Following two indices are used for scoring to assess the surgical difficulty during the surgical removal of the impacted third molar. Number one is the Pedersen's difficulty index scale, and number two is the Warfe's difficulty index scale. As per Pedersen difficulty index scale, we score the value. As per these parameters, first column is the parameters, angulation, depth, and space. Second is the classifications, and third is the scoring value. Like for mesioangular, we give 1 score, for our horizontal number 2, for vertical 3, and for distoangular 1. Position A 1, B 2, position C 3, class 1, 1, class 2, 3, and class 3, 3. The significance is that of this difficulty index, if the scoring value comes 3 to 4, it is the minimally difficult impactions to remove. If the scoring value comes in between 5 to 6, it is the moderately difficult impactions to remove. And if the scoring value comes 7 to 10, then it will be very difficult impactions, like distoangular impactions, class 3 impactions, position to C impactions. It will be very difficult impactions because the scoring value comes more than 7. Then the second surgical difficulty index is the Warfe's difficulty index for assessing the surgical difficulty based on various factors like Winters classifications, height of mandible, angulation of the third molar, root shape, follicle development, path of exit of the tooth during the removal. The scoring number denotes the difficulty in surgical removal of the impacted tooth. Tooth with 0 score being the easiest to extract, and as the number increases scoring value, the difficulty also increases. As per this index, the different parameters are shown in first column. Second parameter is the category, and third is the scoring value. 33 is the highest score value. Then the another radiological assessment is the arc of the wheel rotations. The mesioangular and the mesially facing horizontal impactions, they are impacted against the crown of the second molar. They have to be tilted upward by elevating, thereby clearing the crown of second molar either in toto or in or injections to check whether it can be removed only by removing the overlying bone alone or need tooth sectioning as well, the following test can be done. The line, that is the diameter, can be drawn from the apex of the distal root of the third molar to the tip of its mesial cusp, and with this line as the radius of an arc, circle is formed. If the circle passes or rotate clear from the crown of the second molar, the tooth sectioning is not required. This is your preoperative assessment. You need not to section the tooth if this circle is rotating clear from the crown of the second molar. But if the rotating arc, that is a circle formed by that diameter, if it cut through the image of the crown of the second molar, then definitely the tooth sectioning is must during the during the elevation of the third molar. Else, if you don't do the sectioning of this tooth, either you will luxate or you will remove the second molar, or your third molar may get fractured, or you may create the pathological fracture of the bone, angle of the mandible. Now we'll go for the surgical technique for the removal of the impacted third molar. Irrespective of the technique we used for removal of the third molar, the following steps have to be followed, and they are the preoperative preparation of the patient, which include obtaining the consent of the patient, verbal and written, the surgical instrumentation set, arranging, asepsis and isolation of the surgical site with cleaning and scrubbing, and painting with Cevalon 70% alcohol and 5% povidone-iodine for facial skin, and with 1% povidone-iodine or betadine solution for oral mucosa. After scrubbing the surgical site, we should isolate it by draping the patient's head and chest with the sterile drape and linen, so that only the surgical site is open to the operator. Following this, the anesthesia is obtained, either local or sedation or GA, depending upon the indications and requirement in every case. But in majority of the patient, it is mostly done safely and comfortably under the local anesthesia with pterygomandibular nerve block supplemented with the lingual and long vocal nerve block, in minor OT on physiological dental chair and unit under local anesthesia. In any well-set dental clinic also it can be done if you follow the asepsis and principle of surgery. Then number three, the designing of the incision designing and reflection of the mucopreostial flap for better visibility and adequate exposure of the operative site. All the basic principle of flap designing should be followed, like wide base, adequate exposure. It should not cut any nerve and vessel at the margin, and most commonly recommended mucopreostial flap for third molar surgical removal, it is number one, it is the envelope flap. It is designed for the superficial impactions requiring limited exposure of underlying bone, like the position A impactions and all, which are the partly erupted impactions, superficial impactions. Envelope flap we can take without any vertical oblique incision. This flap has got only the distal incision for 1 centimeter behind the second molar, given distobuccally over the external oblique ridge to prevent the injury to the retromolar vessel and to the lingual nerve. The gingival crevicular incision is extended around second molar from distal aspect of third molar anteriorly up to the first molar. It does not have any anterior vertical incision, and then the flap is reflected to expose the underlying third molar area, the bone and the tooth. The advantage of this flap is that technically it is very easy. It is very easy to close and the healing is faster. The disadvantage is that it gives very limited exposure and access to the underlying bone is difficult. It means inadequate. Second is the triangular flap. It is also known as three-cornered or two-sided flap. It's an envelope flap with anterior vertical oblique incision. It is known as triangular flap. It is indicated in deeper impaction and is most commonly designed flap for the third molar impactions. For designing the triangular flap, the most commonly recommended incisions are Watts incision, modified Watts incision, that is Watt class 2 Watts incision, then the L-shaped incision. Number one is the Watts incision. It is the most commonly used incision and the flap. Here the distal incision for 1 cm is given distobuccally from the distal side of the second molar toward the external oblique ridge. Then from the distal point of second molar, the crevicular incision runs around second molar. And then the vertical oblique incision is given at 45-degree angle from the distal buccal margin of second molar, directing it anteriorly and toward the lower sulcus, but not to extend into the buccal vestibule or sulcus to prevent the injury to the venous plexus and the facial vessels. The diagram is showing the Ward's incision. Then we have got the modified Ward's incision. Here the only difference is that the crevicular incision is extended up to the first molar, and then the vertical oblique incision is taken from the distobuccal aspect of the first molar. So that you get the wider flap for the better exposure. It is also known as Ward's 2 incision. Then following the designing of the mucoperiosteal flap and after reflection of the mucoperiosteal flap with suitable retractor, we go ahead with for the bone removal, adequate bone removal, and then followed by the tooth removal. The adequate bone should be removed to expose the impacted tooth to clear the bony obstructions which prevent the elevation of the tooth. The bone removal we do normally by two techniques. One is the surgical burr technique and second is the chisel and mallet technique. The surgical burr technique is the most preferred technique in all the patients and most commonly used technique for the operation under the LA. During the bone cutting, the pulling with the normal saline or betadine irrigations should be done to prevent the bone necrosis and delay in wound healing. Initially, round burr number 7 and 8 to be used and followed by straight fissure burr number 703 to be used for removal of the adequate bone. If required, the sectioning of the tooth, that is splitting or odontectomy under the normal saline irrigation, to be done in order to prevent the thermal trauma and to preserve the bone and to prevent the traumatic extractions. When we remove the bone with the surgical burr technique, we remove the bone by two methods. Number one is the guttering technique, that is the Moore-Gilbey's technique. And second is the postage stamp technique, that is the lateral trepanation technique. When we remove the bone with the guttering technique, here with the surgical burr under constant irrigations after reflection of the mucoperiosteal flap, after adequate access under the good visibility, the covering bone should be removed buccally, superiorly, distally to expose the entire crown. After this, with the help of further bone cutting, we create the ditch or the groove or the gutter around the neck of the impacted tooth to the level of the cemented enamel junctions from the buccal and the distal aspect. While cutting the distolingual block of bone, the lingual flap should be reflected well to protect the lingual nerve. Its position is normally 2 mm below the crest of the ridge and 0.5 mm supraperiosteally in third molar area. So it is at a very risky area to get traumatized causing the anesthesia of the tongue or the paresthesia of the tongue, and that is why the lingual flap has to be protected well when we cut the distolingual block of bone. Now after creating the ditch buccally and distally, with the help of straight elevator which will be placed on the cemento enamel junction on the medial side of the third molar at an angle of 45-degree angle to the mandible, we elevate and displace the tooth in a created distal space. And finally, after its luxation, the tooth should be removed with the suitable forceps. Now, in case if the tooth has to be removed by sectioning of the tooth or odontectomy, this is done in case if there is unfavorable angulation of the tooth or the position and depth of the impacted tooth is very deep, or if it has got the unfavorable root pattern. It will be advised to remove the impacted tooth by sectioning in order to reduce the amount of the bone removal, and this procedure is known as odontectomy. The odontectomy is done to remove the impacted tooth in pieces without excessively removing the covering bone and not to do the traumatic extractions and to prevent the further risk like fracturing the tooth or fracturing the bone. And because of this philosophy, we always say this adage is there that tooth belongs to the surgeon and the bone belongs to the patient. We should try to preserve the bone when we are removing the tooth. And therefore, in case if it has got all those conditions which are mentioned above, the sectioning is always preferred. The sectioning is done at the suitable site, preferably through the deep groove. The initial sectioning of the tooth is done with the round and fissure surgical bar up to 3/4 of its medio lateral width, and later the splitting and sectioning should be completed by sharp osteotome or straight elevator to split the tooth. Then it should be removed with the suitable elevator or the forceps. The advantages as per Pale and Gregory of tooth sectioning: the amount of the bone removed is less, the operative time is reduced, the field of operation is small, the damage to the neighboring vital structure like tooth, bone, inferior dental canal content is reduced, and the risk of jaw fracture is less. The disadvantages of the odontectomy: in old patient, the splitting of the tooth is very difficult because of the shallow groove and brittle bone, and therefore it may induce the jaw fracture. Second technique of bone cutting is by postage stamp technique. In this technique, the bone removal is done by creating the small, it is done with the help of small round bar, by creating the series of holes which outlines the portion of the bone to be removed. These holes, then they are joined by cutting with the straight fissure bar to remove the, in order to remove the cut bone and to create the surgical window for removal of the impacted tooth by enlarging the surgical window. If this surgical window, if we create on a buccal aspect, it is called as a lateral trepanation technique to remove the impacted tooth in a bud stage in younger. The second technique for removal of the bone is by chisel and mallet technique. It is less commonly used nowadays. It has got only historical importance. We must support the jaw. In older patients with sclerotic bone, it causes the jaw fracture, and therefore it should be avoided. If at all we are using, it should be used in younger patients with the elastic bone under the GA. It causes less bone necrosis. There is a rapid healing. That is the advantages of the bone cutting with the help of chisel. When we are removing the bone with the help of chisel, always the vertical stop cut has to be given behind the second molar with the bevel facing posteriorly. The mandible having the grain trajectory running to the external oblique ridge in the third molar area, and hence chisel cut made parallel or horizontal in the third molar area without this vertical stop cut can split the buccal cortical plate extensively, and hence to avoid this kind of mishap, first the vertical stop cut is given. Now after giving this, the horizontal bone cut is made with the bevel facing down at an 45 degree angle to remove the triangular piece of bone from the buccal aspect. This technique should be avoided in older patients with the skull, since there is a risk of the jaw fracture. Also, it should not be used under the local anesthesia. It is very annoying to the patients. The bone removal should be done adequately, especially from the distolingual aspect of the tooth, to elevate the tooth atraumatically with the judicious force by displacing it in a created space. The diagram, it is showing the stop cut, vertical stop cut, when you are removing the bone with the help of chisel and mallet. Then in this, for removal of the impacted third molar, when it is a lingual version, lingual split bone technique, it was first described by Sir William Kelsey Fry. It is to be used in younger patients with elastic bone for lingualear pleth impaction. It has got the historical importance. It less commonly used nowadays. It takes advantage of the thin lingual cortical plate by fracturing it, thus preserving the thick buccal cortical plate. The bicuprioxial flap is raised as usual, and the vertical stop is made immediately distal to second molar. The second stop cut is made distobuccal to the impacted third molar, and with the horizontal bone cut, the buccal cortical plate is removed. Later, the distolingual distoangular bone is fractured with the chisel and mallet, and thereafter the tooth is elevated and displaced lingually with straight elevator, thereby fracturing the thin lingual cortical plate. The impacted tooth is removed finally with the suitable forceps, and the fractured lingual cortical plate will be dissected out to saucerize the wound. The wound margins are smoothened out with bone file. The wound is irrigated and cleaned. Hemostasis is obtained, followed by closure of the socket with 30 black silk suture. The moist pressure gauze will be given postoperatively with postoperative medications and instruction. This is lingual split bone technique is been shown in the diagram. Then following the removal of the tooth, we do the debridgment and socket and smoothening of the marginal bone and the hemostasis. It is done with the help of curette and the bone file under flushing with the normal saline. To remove all the tissue fragments or debris, including the broken part of the dental follicle, roots from the socket of the reflected flap, complete hemostasis is obtained before closure of the wound by controlling the bleeding. Next, we do the closure of the surgical wound. It is done with 30 black silk suture by placing the first suture immediately behind second molar. Later, the second suture posteriorly to close the wound. Many times, the anterior vertical or oblique incision need not to be closed. It doesn't need the additional suture because it remains well approximated itself. After suturing, it should be covered with the moist sterile gauze pack, and the patient should be asked to close the jaw to apply the firm pressure over it. The picture is showing that the anterior oblique vertical incision has not been closed with the suture, and the hematoma, if it is collected in the third molar area, to prevent the development of the hematoma or swelling thereafter. Following this, the patient will be given the postoperative instructions and medications to maintain the pressure pack at least for 45 minutes to 1 hour. No mechanical disturbances like gargles, gargling, sitting, smoking, speaking, tongue and finger touching to the wound on the day of surgery. Cold application externally on the day of surgery every half an hour on that day. Then the post-operative medications will be given, like oral antibiotics and oral analgesic anti-inflammatory drugs, for 3 to 5 days, and sutures to be removed after 5 to 7 days. Thank you.
Dr. Bhoyer, there are a few questions. There are a number of questions, rather we cannot, because of the limited time. Can you answer a few questions?
Yes, ma'am.
So first question is from Dr. Deepak. How increase or decrease in growth hormone can lead to impaction? Please explain.
This is regarding the growth hormone. Definitely it will affect the overall growth of the person. And there can be, if it leads to the contracted, the small size of the jaw, definitely there will be less space for the eruption of the teeth, which get erupted last, and therefore there is a possibility of the impactions.
Another question from Dr. Bhavav. Is it safe for the patients who are undergoing radiotherapy to undergo minor oral surgeries like impaction removal? What should be the time period between the cycle of radiotherapy and extraction?
Definitely, see, normally all these kind of surgeries should be planned in a patients who are suffering from the oral malignancy and going for the radiation therapy. All the teeth in a target area should be removed preoperatively only. But if at all, if it is not done, and if the surgery is done following the radiation therapy, then there will always be possibility of the osteoradionecrosis because of the poor healing. And therefore, if at all the surgery is done, it has to be done in consultation with the radiotherapist under the antibiotic cover and following the radiation therapy, normally the period should be it should be delayed, and the consultation should be made with the radiotherapist.
One more, please. How should we proceed for the extraction of dilacerated tooth?
As I mentioned, one of the indications for the transalveolar extraction is the the tooth with the dilacerated roots. And if it is found that on the radiological assessment, if the tooth is dilacerated having the unfavorable root pattern, then the surgical extraction should be planned by replacing the mucoperiosteal flap, and the bone should be uncovered to the area of the bifurcation area, and then the root should be sectioned and the tooth should be removed in pieces.
Thank you, Dr. Bhoria. It was an excellent and minutely described webinar. As minor surgical procedures are very important for general dentists as well as the molar maxillofacial surgeons, the impacted third molar removal is bread and butter for oral and maxillofacial surgeons. So you have described each and every aspect of the surgical techniques.
Thank you.
So anyone can get stuck up during even during the simple extraction, but I think if proper pre-operative planning is made and the treatment plan is made accordingly, this is the solution for complicated teeth. Thank you so much. So for those who logged late, I will repeat the five topmost colleges who have the highest attendance in the last webinar: Savitha Dental College and Hospital, Chennai; St. Joseph Dental College, Ellore; Peninsula Mahavidyalaya Institute of Dental Sciences, Hyderabad; Thai Mugambi Gay Dental College and Hospital, Chennai; Guru Nanak Dev Institute of Dental Sciences and Research, Kolkata. So the next webinar will be on 28 February 2021, that is a Sunday, at 4 p.m. The topic will be Clinico-Pathological Perspective of Developmental Anomalies of Teeth. The speaker will be Dr. Rajiv Desai, who is Professor and Head, Nair Hospital Dental College, Mumbai, and Dr. Alka Kale, who is Professor of Oral Pathology and Microbiology and Principal of KLE Institute of Dental Sciences, Belgaum. So before we conclude, I must thank Dental Council of India, including President, Vice President, Secretary, Executive Council members, webinar committee, Dr. Varinder Goyal and Mr. Mukesh, who is a Deputy Secretary, Akshita, for giving this platform and their support for making the smooth conduction of this webinar. I really appreciate the participants for sparing their valuable time and their contribution for the success of this webinar. And I expect the same will continue in the next webinar. Thank you so much.